What we need to do is turn this meeting over to Ryan and Sergeant Anton and for the swearing in of our new directors before we can move forward on any more of the agenda. So at this time, Ryan?
Yeah, I just had a typo, like Greg said, on the original agenda. We just had included the names of the previous directors and hadn't exchanged them out for the new directors. So that's the only change that was made to the agenda. And I guess at this time, Sergeant Anton doesn't mind doing the oath for our three new elected directors. I don't know if you guys want to step up here with Sergeant Anton.
I state your name.
I.
Discharge.
The duties upon which I am about to enter.
Duties upon which I am about to enter. Phew, that was a hard one.
That was a test.
Oh. He's got it.
Mine's.
Gerald?
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant.
Keep your fishing, it's going.
On number six, Director's Board Position Nominations.
Should we do roll call?
You're right. Okay, I'm sorry. Roll call. Director Greg Wood here. Director Bill Parkman.
Here.
Director Justin Wright.
Absent.
Director Cheryl Romo.
Absent.
Director David Hernandez.
Here.
Director Donna Morris.
Here.
Director Gerald Morris.
Here.
Okay. And with that, let's move to item B. That way we can get our board positions situated and move forward with the meeting. So let's open the nominations up for board chairman. Do we have any nominations?
I'd like to nominate Greg Wood.
Second.
Any other nominations for board chairman? Okay, at this time, all in favor of Greg Wood as board chairman?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? And it carries. Thank you very much. Vice chairman, nominations for vice chairman?
Bill Parkman, please.
Second.
Any other nominations for vice chairman? Okay, all in favor of Bill Parkman for vice chairman? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Congratulations. Okay, we will go with secretary. Do I have any nominations for secretary?
Nominate Donna Morris.
Second.
Any other nominations for secretary? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Congratulations.
Thanks, guys.
Now, hold off on that one. You may not be thinking.
It wasn't a smile.
And then here is your director.
Going down there. No, it has to go at the end.
This makes me very happy.
Dennis, you made it.
Sort of. No, we're
okay. We're
fired.
We're to item four, adopt agenda. We have a motion to adopt agenda. We have a motion by.
Yeah, I make the motion.
I'll second it.
Okay. Motion made by Vice Chairman Parkman, seconded by Secretary Morris. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item 5, approved minutes.
Motion that we approve them as per written.
Second.
Okay. Motion was made by Secretary Morris, seconded by Director Hernandez. Any discussions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, let's move to item 7, community leader reports. Kern County Supervisor.
Just one item today. The Board of Supervisors announced the selection of their new county administrative officer. It will be Ryan Alsop. He is a former assistant CAO from LA County. He's a Bakersfield native, Kern County native. Very well-known, very hardworking, smart guy. We think he's going to be the right guy for the job. Supervisors are very excited. He's going to be taking over in January. We look forward to his leadership and what he's going to be able to do in a challenging budget time. And he's embraced those challenges, and he seems to be ready for them. So we wish John Nylon all the best. He was a great CAO, very smart, hardworking man, and he deserves to ride off in the sunset. So he's retiring, and we wish him all the best.
Great. Any questions from the board? Yes, John.
Could I ask you to provide us with a picture of the new chief executive officer?
Yes, I can, but I don't have one. Right,
well, now. When you get one.
Yes. I will send one out to the email list.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
I'll send his bio to you.
Okay.
Okay, any questions from the board for Ryan? Kern County Fire Department. Okay, Kern County Sheriff's Office.
Sergeant Anton from the Sheriff's Department. There is no announcement on the substation yet. I haven't heard any new words one way or another. For the month of November, we had 626 calls for service, 19 arrests, and 76 reports cleared.
Any comments from the board for the Sheriff's Department? California Highway Patrol.
We meet all the night with the committee watch program. Talked to Sergeant Williams, Lieutenant Williams from Highway Patrol. He gave me the stats. From the Mojave area statistics of November 2016 for the communities of Rosamond, Mojave, Tehachapi, North Edwards, Boron, Angel Current, Trona, Randsburg, Johannesburg, the SR-14, SR-58, SR-395, SR-178. During that month, there was 78 traffic collisions, 4 fatalities, 8 hit and runs, 31 impaired drivers arrested, 620 miscellaneous arrests, 639 disabled motorists that they assisted, 192 reckless drivers, 8 highway violence, 5 brandishing a firearm, 5 car fires, 8 abandoned vehicles, 8 loose animals, 7 wrong way drivers, 54 suspicious circumstances calls, 1,070 infraction traffic citations. Also, too, the Highway Patrol started in December of 2016. December 30th, they will be doing a sobriety checkpoint through the Mojave area of Tehachapi, Rosamond, Boron, and Mojave. That will be starting December 30th.
I always thought it was interesting they warned you about
that. We have to by law, but they also have to be
I just never understood why they
have to. But yeah, so I'm going to tell you what they are. This month, due to the expected rains and the holidays, we're planning to start our cleanups back up in January. We are hopefully going to be doing more than one a month, because there are several sections of Sierra Highway that are in desperate need of attention. And we have someone who's volunteered to come out and help us. After we get the trash out of the ditches, they're going to come out and unload and try to get rid of some of those weeds so the trash will not continue clinging there and staying there. So we're hoping to do it at least twice a month, maybe more. And we're going to do one section at a time and give it a thorough cleaning each time. Also, we We're working with the county to get a color match for the planters that are on Diamond Street. Once we have that paint, we have permission anytime the graffiti is noted, we have permission to go out and immediately cover it up.
Service district.
Just a few things. Actually, not a few things, just a couple things. First of all, we are meeting next Tuesday. And one of the things we'll be discussing about whether we'll be meeting on January 3rd, because the week prior to that, staff will be off. So we might not meet on January 3rd, we have that calendar. We will be discussing starting strategic planning, which should be of interest to you all. All five facets: water, sewer, street lighting, importantly parks and recreation, and graffiti abatement. All those things are purposes and powers of the RCSD, and all those things need to be planned, and we're looking forward to figuring out a way to do that a little more in depth than has been done in the past. That's all I've got. Tuesday at 7.
I have a question. We're still getting calls in our office a lot about street lights. What should I tell them regarding if there's is there a way for their area to get a revote, and if there is, what do they have to do?
They need to get enough people together in their neighborhood, find out how big the neighborhood is.
Is it like a majority or no?
Well, I think you want to have a significant amount of people say, you know, we forgot to vote last time. For example, the neighborhood across the street, I think 7 people voted. And there's obviously about 30 homes there or more. And not the whole neighborhood, but the 1-2 blocks. Mm-hmm. Another neighborhood, most of them are smaller neighborhoods.
Is there a concrete number?
No, it's a substantial number of people who say, if you vote next time, we're willing to go ahead and vote this time. We're going to vote yes.
So just
and number two, when we vote yes, we know that we're going to have a little bit more say than we would have last time if we'd have voted.
So we should tell them if they call us, is, you know, just get your neighbors to ask them for a revote.
Yeah. Okay. But they didn't sign a petition.
Oh. Okay.
Okay. So the way ahead then, because I think you're leaving a step out.
Yeah.
Who should he refer them to?
Or what should I tell them to do if they want a revote?
Here's the action. You know, go to the office, pick up the paper, you know, stand in a box, scream like a chicken.
I think they should, if they have any questions, you know, talk to the general manager, Ron Smith. Certainly they can talk to the board of directors, okay. Let them know that. And each of us has our own opinion.
I just don't want to point them in their own direction. I just want to tell them to do it.
My personal opinion is that they, you know, if they want to contact me, I'm fine with that. Okay. But I'll tell them.
Well, I didn't know if you wanted me to get them.
And that's fine. Just let them know. I don't have any problem with that. My opinion is different. You know, we all have different opinions. But actually, I don't even know what the rest of their opinions are as far as what the number cutoff is. Okay. But I do know if you get a substantial amount of people interested, then obviously the board's going to listen a little bit more carefully than if it's just one or two people saying it. So that's
yeah, so different. Probably referring them to Smith there at that office.
Okay.
And saying, what's our guidance? What paperwork do we need to fill out? You know, we need to come there and pick it up.
All off that.
What's our way ahead?
Ron Smith first. Yeah, Ron Smith first. Yeah, would be best.
I'm just kidding.
And then he's got 3451?
I have it.
256, I mean. But that would be best to go to the RCSD first, and then obviously any board director you can call.
Okay. Thank you. I just want to know what to tell them.
Okay. Ron Smith's direct line is 256-5807. 5807. Any other question? The Rosen Foundation? No report. Rosen Chamber of Commerce?
Yeah, not much. We had a parade. December 3rd, I believe it was. And we had 32 entries. It was a nice parade and a good turnout. The Tropical Middle School Band and Choir performed as well. And they all did a great job. And we had a lot of great entries, ROTC entries, and so forth. And so it was a good parade. Other than that, we're still working on the event center with the county. And, all I have to report for December.
I have a question in regards to that event center. You're saying you're working on it. Exactly what's taking place?
Well, there's a lot of county code regulation and requirements that we have to meet. And until we get those resolved with the county, for example, the structure did not meet the wind specifications that's being donated for the main stage area there. And so they had, the company agreed to reinforce it up to the 130 mile an hour requirement. So, you know, we're dealing with a lot of those types of requirements. And once we get past all that and get through the code compliance process, then we can get our permit and start building. So we already had all the block wall donated. And so it's just a matter of waiting for the permit process.
So you have a drawing rendition of it?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
We have full plans and our renderings and all of that.
All right, Rosamond Youth Football and Cheer. Anybody here?
Mike said.
Okay.
They said I was going to be here.
Okay, very good. Southern Kern Unified School District.
I can give her a little report on that. Coach Chris Crimpian, the football coach, has been selected to coach the All-Star team in the Central Section because his program has improved at Rosamond High, and that's kind of an honor. The district is going to serve breakfast, lunch, and take-home meals in bags during the holidays to people 18 and under. If you're 19 and older, you pay $2 for the meal. And they're going to be served at Rosamond Elementary School. Breakfast from 8 to 10. Lunch from 12 to 2. And they plan to expand that during the summer. Every day during the summer, and serve meals at Tropical Middle School as well. So all the people that want breakfast, lunch, and take-home dinner for people at home can get it from the school district. The developer fee, which had been $3.55 a square foot, was raised to $7.10 a square foot. So anybody thinking of building has now got to contend with $7.10 a square foot until Governor Brown decides to release the money that the voters voted on. Once he decides to release that money, the fee will go back down to $3.55.
Any questions from the board? Thank you, John.
Welcome.
Antelope Valley Citizens for Responsible Water. I don't see Mr. Scott here this evening.
Randy's out of town.
And Edwards Air Force Base.
Only one source for that.
From Edwards Air Force Base, greetings. You've been drafted. did any of you watch Jay Leno's Garage last night? I mean, the show, not go there and see his garage.
No. I'd like to see his garage.
Jack.
No, yeah. Get through it,
Edwards was featured. So Jay came out last year, which prompted the Secretary of the Air Force to come out. I know you're shocked. And they let him race some kind of a car that he built with a jet engine that was still shaft-driven, but up and down the runway. And apparently at some point a window exploded out. Stuff happens. So that everybody was waiting with bated breath for that event. When he was here, and the Secretary of the Air Force was here, they had a little social gathering with honorary commanders and others, you know, that evening. And I was fortunate enough to get my picture taken with Jay.
Can you tell the difference?
Yeah. I didn't have the same chin.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and he had a lot more hair. So there's that. Based on the calls and the inquiries I'm getting, we're looking ahead toward the 2017 flyover schedule. The folks from the LA County Air Show have been talking to us about what support we can give. We always have to wait every year. It's kind of a race because we have to wait for the guidance to come down from on high as to what we can and cannot offer. I know that they would love to open their show with a sonic boom. Now, you can't just do those anywhere. Fortunately, we have two, count them two, authorized overland supersonic corridors here. One of them is pretty much right over the top of town. You probably haven't figured this out already. You know, the high-level supersonic corridor starts way out west, I think in Ventura County, if memory serves me, the other side of Fraser Park and Corbin, and runs east-northeast to the Colorado River. You have to be at least 30,000 feet above mean sea level. I've forgotten how wide that corridor is. But what they want to do is hang to the south side of it and stay in the corridor, but create the boom, because the boom, unruly as it is, doesn't stay in the little dotted lines on the map. It goes beyond that. For every 1,000 feet a plane is above the ground, the noise goes out about a mile, so a half mile either side of centerline, roughly. Atmospheric conditions, everything in the world to do with it. We're talking about the end of March, March 25th-ish. And so the air should be a little cooler, which means it should carry. They're going to have the Thunderbirds. I think when they were first suggesting an air show time, they were hoping for October. It's a nice time of year. However, by having the air show, the LA County Air Show at Fox Field, in March, it's like the first air show of the season. Consequently, we have a really good luck, or they have had real good luck, with getting the precision flying teams, the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds. They're hoping to get the F-35 Heritage flight there too, but the guy that is running that was very non-committal to John Fergione, who's was at the International Commons Bear Show, was asking the questions. So, but it promises to be a good show. The F-22s, if you're familiar with our flight line at all, are moving down the ramp. They're way up at the north end, almost to NASA land, and now they're moving down to where the F-16s used to be. Now, in order to do that, the F-16s had to move out first, and then they had to refurbish those spaces now that they can move in, and now the refurbishing will be once they get fully out. The spaces that the F-22 folks had up at the north end, ramps 11 and 12, if you're familiar with that area. And we're not sure who's going in there yet. It's four good-sized hangars, so and they're going to use all four of them, apparently. Other than that, we found out this last month that the schools on base are getting, which are part of the Muroc School District, which the headquarters for that is North Edwards. They also oversee the schools in Boron, are getting grant money to fix the schools up. This is way past due. And they don't have all the money lined up yet, but the first couple of schools they do. So, and over the course of the next 10 or 12 years, then those schools will be upgraded. It's a huge plus. And quite frankly, it's a very big deal to attract folks into that career path. I'm talking specifically of pilots and engineers.
Yeah.
You know,
the desert needs it bad.
Yeah.
I took a tour there, and there's roots growing from classrooms. And
right.
Trees. No joke.
No, I know. Yeah.
Out on the floor.
The high school, I don't know if I've mentioned this in a meeting before, is located at the funniest intersection on the base. The high school is located at the intersection of pain and love. Where love ends at pain, there's high school. And they didn't plan it. This stuff is everywhere, guys, if you look around. So I actually met the general that named that street. And the first time I saw it, I was given a private with General Conley. He was the flight center commander when the shuttle program was beginning. And I saw that sign, it just hit me, and I put it together real fast. And he was giving a tour to a couple of his friends from Santa Barbara. And he starts laughing like crazy. He says, "Dennis, I'm the guy that named Love Boulevard. You set me up all those years ago. This didn't occur to you before?" It was too good. So, point is, Edwards Air Force Base is alive and well. There's a lot of stuff coming down the pike. A lot of, we just had our test pilot school graduation. You probably saw that in the paper. You know, you got the release, didn't you?
Yeah.
So, there are more people authorized to wear a Super Bowl ring because they were on the team who won the Super Bowl than there are people authorized to wear the test pilot school graduate patch on their flight suit.
Mm.
So we've got the cream of the crop here. There was a change of command, the 418th Flight Test Squadron, which is the squadron that deals with tankers, like the KC-135, the new KC-46, the C-130s, KC-10s, C-5s, the big heavy planes. That now has they have a new commander. And we still have around 10,000 folks working there. Impact is still about $1.5 billion a year. So, yeah, we're alive. Hold on. Oh, and this could make me happy. This is proof, as if Olaf and I were proof of this before, that you don't really have to be that good looking to be on the board, except for the ladies. There's some really ugly guys up there. And we've got hearts of gold. But...
Okay, community announcements. Bonafide representatives of community service organizations and clubs are invited to announce upcoming events open to the public. And please limit your presentations to no more than 3 minutes. Are there any presentations?
Under other, one up there, just remember Saturday during the aviation, like Dennis says, up in Mojave, that Dick Bertano was speaking about the 30th anniversary of the Voyager flight. That should prove to be pretty interesting. You get a chance to get up to Mojave Air Space Force. Okay. Get there early so you get a seat. I think you have to pay for it this time. Or there's passengers getting there. First come, first serve.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Item 9, public comment period. Any member of the public may address the council regarding any matter concerning the Logan residents. This need not be related to any items on the agenda. However, law prohibits the council from taking action on matters not on the agenda. Please limit presentations to 3 minutes. And in regards to our new board members, just to give you an idea on the public comment period, we cannot take action, but you are allowed to ask questions for information. You need to ask a follow-up question. If somebody's out there bringing something to the board, you can ask questions for clarification and things like this. But you cannot take any action as a board until it's agendized. Okay? And any public comments? Yes, Dennis.
Over the years that I've lived here in Lisbon, there have been maybe less than half a dozen times that I've called the Sheriff's Department for service, you know, the department for service block. And without fail, every single time, the folks have been there in a timely manner, handled things professionally. I think we have one of the finest service organizations here in our community. Whether they have a building here or not, they're still doing a stellar job. And I wanted to have them recognized for that. Thank you for your service.
John, you had your hand up.
An item of interest. Kern Cog came to Hummel Hall on Monday to talk about bike paths and sidewalks. And they brought 8 very knowledgeable people. They brought a whole room full of maps of Rosamond. Unfortunately, the maps are just a tiny part of Rosamond. If you know how big the zip code 93560 is, it covers a vast area. The same with the Southern Kern Unified School District boundaries. It's a vast area. The maps they brought only go out to about 40th Street. One of them went to 90th, but The point is that when they count the number of people to make the grants for sidewalks and bike paths, they're only counting a very small section of the community. And they stress that they have money available, the state has money available, but they have to go through these planning community sessions to build proof. And I said, well, you should have given us some warning ahead of time so we could get more people to turn out. And they promised, yes, they do that. They're coming back in spring. But I was thinking it might not hurt if the RMAC would send them a letter to Kern COG, the Kern Council of Governments, and just make them aware of the zip code area boundaries, the school district boundaries. I mentioned to each one of them, and they were totally ignorant of it. I called it up on my iPhone, and I showed what the boundaries were, and they were flabbergasted.
Kern COG?
Kern COG, yes.
Do you everyone aware of who Kern COG is?
Mm-hmm.
They're the Kern Council of Governments. They're the only entity in Bakersfield that actually takes our tax money and puts it back in our roads, totally. But they only do regional roads. They don't do the little roads. They do like Hazardville Streams Highway, Sierra Highway, more.
So highways.
The more prominent ones they've done is taking 395 and making it a four lane in two different counties. I think Mono and Indio County. Is that right, Brian?
I believe so.
Yeah. So that's, there's a lot of money, but it's pulled in one spot, not much spent really here. But it's important that they should know you're here, because they should actually have a meeting, get an RMAC meeting, I think, rather than 4 p.m. on Monday night.
That might be a good group to have come in.
Yeah, especially that group with that much power and influence, they should be working with the RMAC. You should let them know.
I happened to go to that meeting also.
Yes.
Just like you stated, there was maybe a dozen people here, and there should have been a lot more. But it was very informative, and I actually invited them already. And they said, well, our agenda's pretty full. And they mentioned around June or July. So I told them to get in contact with RMAC. And
I can also invite them and ask them to speak if you guys would like.
Yeah, that'd be great. Can you set that up, Ryan, to get contact information, please?
Yes, I will. And I'll send it to the board.
Let's move on to the business meeting portion. Item 10, standing committees reports.
We need to select the new committee members.
Okay.
So usually we have three directors per committee.
Okay, at this point, let's start with the planning committee. And currently it's Parkman, Romo, and myself. And I would like to, any directors that would like to be on the planning committee, now would be the time to put your hand up and serve in that committee. Each one has a purpose of what they do, and accurate feedback and proposals from the Kern County Planning Department, and that's kind of a biggie. You know, that's the one that gets into stuff in the community that's going to involve a lot of changes, you know, in planning, construction, things of that nature. I would like to stay on that committee. And Bill, you still want to stay on it?
Yes, I do.
Okay, Cheryl Romo's not here, so at this point I will open it up to any of the new directors that would like to serve on the planning committee.
I'd like to serve on that one.
Okay. And anyone else? Okay, then we will go ahead and have the planning committee to be Parkman, Donna Morris, and Greg Wood. Safety committee, again, Romo, Wood, and Wright. I would like to stay on this. Director Wright's not here this evening, or Romo. I don't know if they still want to be on that committee. Does any of the new members want to be on the safety committee?
That one I can do.
Okay, so that would be Director Gerald Morris. Anyone else? Okay, then I will go ahead and leave that right now, Ryan, with myself and Director Morris, and then we'll wait for Cheryl and Justin to see which one of them wants to be on the Safety Committee. Public Health and Community Welfare Committee, that was our former Landsguard, former directors Landsguard and Schaffner and Webb. So this one is open, all three positions. Any directors want to serve on that committee?
I can serve on that one.
Okay. And,
all right, you can put me on that one.
Okay, don't make me pick.
I'm waiting.
Okay, so why don't we just, you know what? That's a good one. We'll put both Director Morris on there and Director Hernandez.
There you go.
On the Public Health Community Welfare.
See what happens when you don't speak up?
Okay, Public Works. I would like to be on this one as well. And Bill, do you still want to be on?
Yeah, I'd like to stay on this.
Okay. So let's go ahead and open up Director Wright. Anybody wish to be on Public Works Committee?
Kind of like that, and better than I would the
Public Relations. You can be on that as well.
We'll just have to make sure we leave open things for the other director.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If nobody wants to be on Public Works, then we'll leave it as it is. In Public Relations Committee, Landsguard, Romo, and Webb. Romo will be on there. And Director Hernandez would like to be on there. And I need one more director that would like to be on the Public Relations.
Okay.
Okay, Gerald Morris, he'll be on that as well. So if I've got this right, Planning Committee will be Morris, Parkman, and myself. Safety Committee will be myself, and then we're going to wait to hear from Directors Romo and Wright.
Just so you, the chairman can appoint the members if he wants.
Okay, then let's go ahead and leave the Safety Committee as it is right now then.
So put Wright in there?
Yeah, Wood, Romo, and Wright.
You already have Wood and Morris.
Oh, I'm
Morris,
sorry,
Gerald
Morris, and then let's go ahead and put Justin in there for the Safety Committee. And Public Health and Welfare Committee, read back who we have for that one.
Donna Morris, Gerald Morris, and David Hernandez.
Okay. And Public Works is Bill, myself, and
Director Wright's always been on the public.
Director Wright, so we'll keep that one the same. And then Public Relations is
Romo, Hernandez, and Gerald.
Okay. Yeah, I think we are all set. Okay. Old business. Item 8. RMAC to review and approve a letter to the Kern County Board of Supervisors and the Kern County Planning Department requesting the county investigate the street lighting issue in Rosamond. I got a letter written for this and I've handed it out to all the directors. This is the first draft of it, and it's probably you're all going to want to have input into changes or revisions on this before we submit it to Board of Supervisors. But I'll go ahead and read what we have so far. This is to the Kern County Board of Supervisors through Zack, Scrivener, Second District Supervisor, from Rosamond Municipal Advisory Council, Reyes Streetlights in Rosamond. This letter is to inform you of a serious safety issue in the community of Rosamond in regards to streetlights being shut off in Rosamond, and to bring to your attention the concerns of the Rosamond Municipal Advisory Council and the members of the community of Rosamond. The Rosamond Community Service District recently held a Proposition 218 mail-in election where the majority of respondents voted to turn off the streetlights in 9 LLAD2 zones of benefit. LLAD2 is a lighting and landscaping assessment district. As for background, back in the 1960s when the Rosamond Community Service District was formed, they were given as one of their powers streetlights. And a $1 per month charge on monthly bills was established to pay for streetlights. The Rosamond Community Services District does not own streetlights, Edison does. And Edison also maintains and upgrades the lights. The Rosamond Community Service District does not determine where new lights go or how many lights to be installed in neighborhoods or arterial lighting. Kern County does this function. The only power Rosamond Community Service District has in regards to streetlights is to collect revenue to pay the Edison bill. For years, the dollar a month collected was enough revenue to pay for the Edison bills and to also develop a reserve. But over time, the $1 a month was no longer sufficient, so the reserves had to be utilized to pay the energy bills. Because of the passage of Proposition 218, the RCSD could not simply increase the dollar a month to a higher amount without it going to a vote of the people. In 2005, the RCSD created LLAD2, and all new homes constructed and the streetlights associated with the new construction would have the cost of streetlights added to their property tax bill, and the $1 a month would remain on their water sewer bill to pay for arterial lighting. But since 2005, the reserves continue to be used to help pay for the monthly energy costs. In 2014, the RCSD held a Proposition 218 election for 40 zones of benefit to incorporate all of the remaining homes into LLAD2. And the result of that election had multiple zones voting to have their streetlights shut off. This was unacceptable to the RCSD board, who voted to borrow $50,000 of water revenue to help pay the energy bills until a new vote could be held. In 2016, a new Proposition 218 vote was held with all the less zones voting to have their streetlights turned off. The fact is there are 440 homes slated to have their lights turned off and removed. Now, we wanted to make it very clear that the RCSD followed the law and conducted the election according to Proposition 218, but the results from a public safety standpoint are unacceptable. While it is the sovereign right of the RCSD to conduct a Proposition 218 mail-in ballot, it is not the only option available to them under Proposition 218. And the fact that they so disagreed with the results of the 2014 election only to use the same formula for the 2016 is surprising. While Kern County has no authority to dictate how the RCSD conducts their business or elections, they do have authority and an obligation to protect public safety. While the revenue of $1 a month is still being collected on all water bills to pay for arterial lighting, it is only a matter of time before that becomes insufficient to pay the related energy costs. And then the community will be faced with voting to shut those lights off as well. So to address the 440 homes facing turnoff and the possible future turnoff of arterial lighting, the RMAC has the following recommendations for the Board of Supervisors to consider. Number one, pass an ordinance that would prohibit the turning off or removal of existing streetlights. Number two, establish a streetlight code that would determine a minimal amount of streetlights per square mile, per number of houses, per capita, etc. If these recommendations are adopted, then the community will be protected from streetlights being turned off and thus ensure public safety. Streetlights provide protection from crime and provide safety for people and children walking or playing out after dark. They also enhance the property values and keep insurance rates low. They also provide visibility and safety for our police as they patrol our neighborhoods. None of these recommendations will infringe on the RCSD and their ability to govern within their powers. It will simply take away their ability to have the option of shutting off streetlights, and they will have to look at their many other options under Proposition 218 to exercise their power of collecting revenue to pay for the energy costs. Thank you.
What other options does the RCSD have under 218?
Well, under Proposition 218, they can go in for a they can go in for a mail-in ballot for a parcel. They can go in for as they've done before, mailing it to all of the customers, and the property owners vote on it. They can go with a county-wide. They can actually not go with the LLAD 2 zone of benefit. They can go with a general election for the public, basically saying, look, it's, you know, streetlights $1 a month, we need to raise it to $6 a month or $5 a month or whatever that number might be, and then go to a vote of the public where everybody in Rosamond pays the same amount of money per month and not have it based upon the zone of benefit. There's a lot of different options that they can explore. And, you know, to go with something to where people can vote to have lights turned off, it's just not, it's not just not the way to do it. You know, and a lot of people have a hard time understanding that, you know, when I was on the board in 2014, you're only required to have one public meeting. We had 7 public meetings. And sometimes the people just couldn't understand it. They would say, we don't want it on our property tax. Well, there is no choice. You know, we can't raise it on your water bill. Any increase has to go on property tax. But, you know, it's just, there was a lot of confusion. A lot of people didn't understand. And, you know, personally, I felt that the RCSD did not take enough time to educate the public. As you can see, Director Landsgaard was saying that they're talking about going for another vote on the zones that were shut down. And if they get those 9 zones to go ahead and take a revote and they agree to the LLAD2, it still leaves the fact that at some point in the future, the arterial lighting, which is your Rosen Boulevard and 20th Street and, you know, all the lighting in the neighborhoods that go up the main streets, that's what the $1 a month pays for. But if energy costs go up and all of a sudden that $1 doesn't cover that, you know, it might be 5 years from now, it might be 10, maybe 20 years. It doesn't matter, but at some point, they're gonna have to go back to the people and say, okay, you know what? You need to vote to have this increased amount of money, and if it's not, then we're going to start shutting off all the lights on Rosen Boulevard and things like that, and that's just unacceptable. So this is kind of to get this out to the Board of Supervisors to maybe take some action that will prevent the streetlights from going off regardless, and to also take some action for the future to prevent the streetlights from ever being shut off. And so this is the best way that I could think to come up to make a recommendation to the Board of Supervisors, but also not to infringe on the rights of the RCSD, you know, and to not tell them how to do their job, just to say, okay, the way you're doing your job now, you can't do it that way. You're going to have to go back to the drawing board and come up with another way to do this. And seeing what Director Landsgaard kind of said, you know, they're kicking around. Everybody has their opinion on how to handle this. Well, they need to sit down as a board and come up with a solution. And the solution is not impacting 440 homes of being dark and, you know, their homes being devalued, public safety, you know, being a factor as well.
Thank you.
I thought the letter was well-written, and I think suggesting the county pass an ordinance prohibiting turning off existing streetlights is a good one. And I think the RCSD should be encouraged to take a proactive improvement of the lighting in Rosamond. Use LED lights and move to solar-powered lights over time, which would reduce the cost of the Edison bill. That could be done, and I believe that the people in Rosamond would support that. But it needs to be promoted. The RCSD needs to make strategy and plan for that. But eventually, the lights in Rosamond could be upgraded to be state-of-the-art, safe for everyone.
So any other comments from the board?
The streetlight, a single streetlight costs $10 a month. That's what Edison typically bills residential areas that have a streetlight on their property, for example, that Edison has provided to them. It's $10 a month. And I kind of see that as probably where the benchmark should be for this. Number one, it gets this thing refunded again, allows them to build up reserves and stuff like that. So, you know, we could certainly make a recommendation, I think, to our CSD that they ought to take a look at what the actual cost is of those things, and take a look at approaching it from the aspect of doing an increase that goes on to the property tax bill. And someone really needs to sit down and explain these things to folks rather than putting it on a flyer in the back of the billing that goes out every month. Because quite candidly, you know, most folks work down, you know, in the big city. They get home, they don't look at the bill, they just pay the thing and just move on. And so there needs to be an education process, too.
Mm-hmm. You know, another thing, too, I've heard people say, well, streetlights go off, they're going to just put a bunch of lights around your house. But researching this, I found out that Kern County has a dark skies ordinance. And it's basically, because of that ordinance, you can't overlight your house because you'll be in violation of that ordinance. So if you go and put a bunch of arterial lighting around your house and your neighbor says, hey, I don't like it, you can be forced to take all that lighting down. So streetlights needs to be what makes our neighborhood safe. Everybody's got lights on their house, they've got the motion detectors and things like that, you know, where it comes on the driveway and things like that. But you know, I remember when the street lights were shut off in 2014, and it was dark, I mean really dark. And so the people, if all of a sudden they go out there and start lighting their houses up like a landing strip at Edwards, you know, they could be in violation of the dark skies ordinance. And then, you know, you get one neighbor that says, hey, I don't like these lights. And then all of a sudden people that have gone out and spent hundreds of dollars on lighting have to remove it because it's in violation. So that's why it's so important that I think that the Board of Supervisors takes a look at saying, okay, get something in writing to essentially just say, okay, now RCSD has to go back and figure this out and not have as an option of shutting lights off. Because the dark skies ordinance that's already in place, when the streetlights go off, the people living on those dark streets don't necessarily have the right to go in there and light their house up like they think they do. So if there's no other questions on this, any revisions, and then before we submit, Ryan, I'll have you look at it too, and if there's any changes or rearranging of the things, we could do that, but I'd like to go ahead and adopt this letter.
Yeah, just someone can make a motion and someone can second it, and you guys can vote for it. Okay. The chairman can sign it.
I'll make a motion that we accept it.
Okay, do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, a motion was made by Secretary Morris, seconded by Director Hernandez. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. RMAC to review and approval letters to the Kern County Board of Supervisors, the Kern County Planning Department, and Kern County Parks Recreation requesting assistance in improving the parks recreation in Rosamond.
I had the lead on this one, Ray, and I'm still working on it. There's a bit of a bit of research on this because everybody's competing for the dollars in the county budget, and unfortunately, parks and a couple of other type of things like that, libraries are all kind of pushed and pushed until they basically get, you know, only a fraction of the money that they really need to operate effectively. And I'm actually thinking that probably the way this needs to work is somewhat similar to the lighting letter, and talking about some type of a parcel tax that deals with maintaining parks and building new parks for that matter, so that you have a financing vehicle for it that isn't subject to the budgetary requirements that we have because of, as we say right now, you know, the collapse of the tax structure because of gasoline prices going down. That's what's really hurting this county. I think we just need to find a funding vehicle for that that's not subject to that volatility.
Right. Okay. Well, we're looking forward to...
We should have something in January.
Okay, that'd be great. Okay, and then the item C, that one has already been, you received that one, Ryan? I know Zack has received a letter and everything.
Yeah, I guess Dennis sent it, I think.
Yeah. And then I got an email from Zack that he was going to get it to the board, the rest of the supervisors, and to all of the pertinent departments. And again.
Was that the safety commission?
Okay. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So that's why I didn't know it was being sent. I thought it was being approved here, so I misunderstood.
Yeah, it's already been sent and everything, because we approved it at the last meeting.
Okay.
And, you know, I just, again, this board wants to thank Kern County and the Sheriff's Department for, you know, bending over backwards and doing everything they can to work on this marijuana dispensary issue in our community. And now that this letter has been sent to the Board of Supervisors, Zack was very appreciative of it. And he, in fact, I can read to you what he had said to me. This is the response I got from Zack Scrivener. Dennis, thanks to you and to everyone on RMAC for your diligence and dedication to addressing this very difficult challenge facing Rosamond and Kern County. I greatly appreciate your acknowledgement that county staff is doing everything we can, and I will make sure the RMAC letter is distributed to the other members of the board and to the appropriate department heads. Sincerely, Zack. So that was in regards to our marijuana letter. And so well done. Okay, item 12, new business. There's no new business. Item 13, Director's Agenda Referrals, items for new business. Anybody have any items you want to have put on future agendas?
Did you guys want the Kern County issue?
Yes, please. There's one that I would like to have put on here. I'm going to need some information on this, but essentially what it is that we have a problem in our community where there is a lot of tractor-trailer operators, semis, that they take their trucks home and they drive them up into the neighborhoods and park them, you know, up in the residential areas. And, you know, and that's all well and good, but unless all of these roads, which I doubt, you know, the residential streets were built for commercial traffic, these big heavy trucks driving on them is going to put undue wear and tear on these streets. And I would like to explore the possibility of just getting Kern County to post signs saying no vehicles over a certain weight allowed beyond this point. And they're just going to have to park their vehicles and then, you know, walk home from there or get someone to pick them up. But
Greg, if you don't mind, I'd like to keep a dialogue over the next month between the next two meetings. I want to find out if there's any existing ordinances or code violations.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. We've got to do some research.
I want to find out what there is, I'll do that, and I'll get back to you.
That'd be great.
Okay.
And then I'll just tell them we...
I'll want me to put it as a discussion item?
Right, discussion, and then that way, once we get all of our ducks in a row, then we can decide, you know, how we want to move forward on it.
Okay, I'll find out.
It's not only in residential areas, it's also like arterial roads, such as 30th Street West, right there by the high school.
Yeah.
There's about two to four rigs that park along 30th Street West there.
The one up on
yeah, because for all I know, there's already ordinances, and those are that's a code violation. I don't know.
Right.
So I'll find it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that'd be great. Any other new agenda items or for discussion? Okay, item 14, Director's Comments. I would just like to start off by thanking Dennis Schaffner and Olaf Landsgaard and Rick Webb for their service to the RMAC. And I would like to congratulate our newest members of the board and welcome aboard. Looking forward to having positive impact from all of you in regards to our community. And also, I want to take this moment to wish everybody a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And we'll see you in 2017. Director Hernandez?
Well, I also want to make sure that everyone has a great season, because in 2017 I really believe just what you made the statement is that we have to get more involved. That's something that is very vital to me and very important. That's why I wanted to get to become an RMAC, and I'm actually excited about what we can accomplish here as a team, and that's the word I want to use, team. Thank you. Merry Christmas.
I just say pretty much the same thing David did. I mean, we are a team, and Rosamond is a team, so I just look forward to this, and thank you. Happy holidays.
Nothing to do. Merry Christmas, all.
Merry Christmas.
Okay, at this point, I would like to get a motion for adjournment.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Okay, I have a motion made by Secretary Morris, seconded by, was that you, Bill?
Mm-hmm.
Vice Chair Parkman, all in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned at 8:19.